got two questions for you. First one is, could you plug in your headphone into the device laying on your chair so you can hear me over that device? And the other question is, could you wait with your questions until the end and use slido.com to ask your questions? It's the first time I'm going to use it, so I'm very curious how this will work. But at slido.com you can input your questions after you inputted the code motion, and other people can upvote questions from people listen to this talk as well. Alright, let's get started. I only got 40 minutes. Normally this talk is an hour and it's based on a training of one day. So let's see how this goes in 40 minutes. My name is Roy Wasser. I am the co-founder of a company called Open Value. We're all about discovering new technologies, the Java ecosystem, building cool stuff basically. And the other co-founder is actually also doing a talk right now in parallel. He's called Belt Petra Schrijver, and he's talking about driverless cars. I'm also a JUG member, an old JUG board member,
just Java user group. And yeah, I'm kind of a blockchain consultant, involved in some different projects currently, and a cryptocurrency fan as well. So, why should you use blockchain in your next application? Well, the main reason is sometimes you just cannot trust a central party for processing your transactions in an honest way. And sometimes these central parties tend to be very expensive. You need to pay them a lot of money to process your transactions. For instance, when you ask a bank to do transactions. We all know how expensive it was to bail out banks in 2008, right? So a guy that thought that we needed a new system was Satoshi Nakamoto. You probably heard of him, right? Or was it the guy, or was it the girl, or was it the group of people? We just don't know. Some people say Satoshi Nakamoto is Nick Szabo. He's a guy that invented a lot of technology that is used in Bitcoin. And other people say that it's probably Hal Finney, who is an American cryptographer, and he received the first Bitcoin transaction of Satoshi Nakamoto. Well, Hal Finney, his neighbor, was called Nakamoto as well, but it was a very old Japanese guy. Hal Finney died in 2014, so we cannot ask him anymore. Satoshi Nakamoto left the scene in 2012, posting a message on a forum where people talked about Bitcoin, saying, "I have moved on to other things," and we haven't heard anything about him. We do know why he came up with blockchain technology, because he wanted to make a payment system that does not rely on a central party. He left us some clue to that. So the first block in the Bitcoin blockchain, the so-called Genesis block, has a free field that you can give any value. And in that field, he inputted the title of an article in the from the Times newspaper from 4 January 2009, Chancellor on the second on the brink of second bailout of banks. So Nakamoto wanted to give us another way to do financial transactions with each other without the need for a central party. So how does this technology work? Well, he needed to solve a couple of issues. The most difficult problem that he needed to solve was the fact that if somebody has $10 or $10 in Bitcoin and he's spending it to two different persons at the same time, then the system should somehow detect this and prevent this from happening, the double spending problem. And also, if you have a payment system that works over the internet, sometimes packages can get lost over the internet, and you don't want your transaction to disappear so that you did lose your money, but the receiving party did not get any money. This is actually a fairly common problem in distributed systems, and it's called the two generals problem. And I got a little video that explains what this two generals problem is exactly. Here we go.
Two armies are preparing to attack the city. Each army is led by a general, and the only way of communicating with each other is by messenger. So thereupon, the two positions either side of the valley, they wait. And then, one of the generals receives a message which indicates the other general is ready to attack. How does the general who delivered the message know that the other general received it? What if the messenger was captured in the valley and the message never arrived? The general would be required to send back a messenger with acknowledgement of message receipt to assure the first general that the second general knows. But if the second messenger never makes it, how will they both know they both know? If the general receives the message, how will the other general know the message has been received unless another message is sent to confirm receipt? But any message could just as easily never make it through. An infinite number of messages would be required. What should these two generals do?
So, what should these two generals do? Well, blockchain has a solution for this problem. And the basic idea is that you should not use a messenger. So imagine that there's a village nearby the battlefield where a group of peasants live, and all the peasants know about what time the enemy should be attacked. Any general can now, at his convenience, visit the village and ask any peasant what time he should attack the enemy. If you ask one peasant, and of course a peasant could make a mistake, let's say there's a 5% chance that he gives the wrong answer, then he just needs to ask more peasants to make sure that he probably has the right answer. If he asks four peasants, then the chance of four peasants giving the wrong answer is really, really small, like you can see here on the slide. So if any of the peasants in the village is malicious and want to purposely give the wrong answer, the wrong time to a general, then this won't be really an issue, as long as the general asks enough peasants. Only if more than half of the peasants give the wrong answer to the general, then there is an issue. And then something called the 50% attack can be executed, which I will go into in a few slides. So the idea is everybody keeps track of all the information, and if somebody wants to know the status, you just ask a number of people in the network or nodes in the network about what's the correct status. Blockchain uses four key innovations to make this system work in a really reliable way. The first is a peer-to-peer network. In a peer-to-peer network, every peer has the same rights and duties as all the other peers. We probably all used a peer-to-peer network. For instance, if you ever downloaded software illegally using torrents, for instance. And the idea of a peer-to-peer network is that every peer is connected to a number of other peers. And peers only want to connect to other peers if they play by exactly the same rules. As soon as a peer decides to change the communication style, change the way it stores data, the connection with other peers is immediately disconnected. This is a very robust system. You can take out any number of peers and the network will just keep functioning, especially in the case of the Bitcoin blockchain. Since all the nodes have the same data, as long as there's one node left, all the data in the peer-to-peer network is retained, and a new node can spin up and connect with the existing node and download all the data from that node. So there's no way that you can take this down. So if there's any country that decides that it's illegal to run a blockchain, then this won't really matter for the functioning of the blockchain as long as there are nodes left in other countries. What you need in this system is a way to reach consensus about what data to store in the blockchain. And the consensus mechanism that Satoshi Nakamoto came up with is called proof of work, which I will explain in a few slides as well. And he thought really well about how to keep this network running without anybody needing to get paid. He thought of a very clever incentive system. It's a self-reinforcing system based on the concept of mining, where people that are processing blocks get paid in Bitcoin. So if we look at the blocks in the blockchain, then we see that one block has many transactions. In the case of Bitcoin, it's 2,500 transactions. So these transactions are all linked in one block, and each block is linked to one other block, and so you get a chain of blocks this way. So if everybody keeps track of all the data, of all the transactions that ever occurred since the beginning of the blockchain, the size of the blockchain will grow really fast. So this is a graph from last year, June last year. The blockchain size of Bitcoin by then was 130 gigabytes. It's currently over 200 gigabytes. So if you want to be a user in the Bitcoin blockchain, you need to download a lot of data. This is, of course, not very convenient if you want to do payments with your mobile phone. Well, there's a solution for that, and it uses the concept of hashing. Who here knows the concept of hashing? Most of you. Let me explain it really fast. Let's say that you have a sentence like hashing is not complicated. You can take for each letter of the sentence its position in the alphabet. You can add together all these positions. You get a number. Let's say that we divide this number by a Julian date. It's a way to describe a date that's easy to use for doing calculations with it. And you then multiply this figure by a million. You get this outcome here. And this is a so-called hash code, which is, well, it should be unique for the specific input. This is, of course, a very simple hashing algorithm, and I cannot guarantee that this is really a unique hash. But the idea is that if somebody else also has the same sentence, hashing is not complicated, and applies the same hash function, they will, of course, arrive at the same hash code. And you now only need to exchange hash codes to make sure that the other party has exactly the same data. So, Bitcoin uses this ID, and most blockchain implementations use this ID in a so-called Merkle tree. The idea of a Merkle tree is as follows. We have the header of a block in the Bitcoin blockchain and all the other blockchains as well. And we have the body, and the body holds the transactions. Now, for each transaction, we make a hash, and we hash this hash together with a transaction hash from another transaction. And these hashes we again hash together until we reach a root hash, which is called the Merkle root. So if you only want to do simple payments with your Bitcoin wallet, you just want to be a simple node that and you just want to spend Bitcoins at different places and you don't want to be do any stuff like mining, now you only need to download the header of each block in the blockchain. And the header is like 8 bytes, and the whole block is like 1 or 2 megabytes big. So this way, if you just want to do payments, you only need to download like 1 or 2 megabytes of data currently to be able to use blockchain. So how does mining work? Well, what you see here on the slide are 4 miners, the blue circles, and all these miners, they have a complete copy of the blockchain sitting on their machine, and they're all trying to find the next block at exactly the same time. And one of these miners will get a reward for finding the next block. So they like to find it as soon as possible. As soon as somebody found it, they tell it to the other miners, and then if the other miners verified the block, then the miner will get its reward. So how do miners select transactions? Well, at any given moment, there are people doing transactions in the blockchain, and miners can decide for themselves what transactions to include in the next block. So like this, we have this transaction pool. These are transactions that need to be processed at this very moment. And the miner at the top left can say, well, I want to include the transaction of Julian, and the miner on top right also wants to include the transaction of Julian. Let's say that the miner on the left selects the transaction of Mark, and the miner on the right, well, he doesn't want to include the transaction of Mark, but he wants to include the transaction of Tina. The reason that he might not want to include the transaction of Mark could be that he doesn't even see the transaction of Mark, because the blockchain network is all installed all over the world. And it can be the case that maybe the transaction is visible at this moment in Taiwan, but it's not visible here in Europe. There's a latency of a few seconds, so it's not always the case that all miners see this exactly the same transactions at any given time. So each miner can decide for itself which transactions to include in a block. So now, after selecting about 2,500 transactions in a block, the miners try to process this block, and one miner will be the fastest. And in this case, this miner found the next block the first, and he will now get 12.5 Bitcoin reward. That reward is halved every 4 years. And he will also get all the transaction fees that are associated with the transactions that he selected. So what does processing a block actually mean? Well, it's actually solving a puzzle. And this puzzle is called the proof of work puzzle. It's a very complex mathematical problem that needs to be solved, and by solving that problem, miners implicitly check if all the transactions that are included in a block are valid. So I tried to lay out how this works on a conceptual level on this slide. So the idea is that you find a missing variable, and it works a little bit like this. Again, we take the phrase hashing is not complicated. We do exactly the same math. We get the number 244. We now say we multiply it by a million, and we now need to find a number that gives us an outcome of this sum that starts with a 9 and ends with 0.4. And the idea in the improved work is that you can only guess what this number is. It's a random guessing. So the miners are brute forcing a solution for this problem. And the first miner to brute force a solution for this problem is the miner that will get the reward for finding the next block and will earn himself 12.5 bitcoins. The nice thing about this puzzle is that it's really hard to find the correct outcome of this puzzle, but it's really easy for all the other miners to check if the outcome was correct. So miners, of course, want to guess the correct outcome of this puzzle as fast as possible, so they keep buying faster hardware. And this hardware currently is using more energy on a daily basis than the energy consumption of Holland on a daily basis. So that's actually maybe a kind of a problem. We'll talk about that a little bit later. All right, so the 50% attack. Blockchain is supposed to be really safe. The only vulnerability it has is a so-called 50% attack. So how would that then work? Well, if anybody made it in cryptocurrency, then you should be buying a Lambda. That's a classic joke in cryptocurrency. So let's say I made it in cryptocurrency and I'm really rich and I now want to buy a Lamborghini. So I let's also say that I have more than 50% of the computing power in the network. So you see my my node here and my local copy, and I have more than 50% of the computing power. What I can do now is go to the Lambo dealer, but first I turn off my computers. Now I go to the Lambo dealer, I ask him what a Lambo costs. He says 15 Bitcoin. I initiate a transaction stating my intention to pay the Lambo dealer 15 Bitcoins. That transaction is processed by the rest of the blockchain network, by the miners. And the Lambda dealer waits until my transaction is successfully processed. So he sees that there's even a block made after the one that just included that transaction. And he now thinks, OK, I can now give Roy the keys to the Lambo. I step into the Lambo. I quickly drive home. And now I turn on my computers again. And I start mining like crazy. And I produce 4 blocks really fast, faster than the rest of the network. I can do that because I have more computing power. All the miners in the network always want to include the longest chain of blocks in their local administration. Why? Well, they're in it for the mining. And mining is finding the next block in the Bitcoin blockchain. And you always need to make sure that you have a local copy of the longest known chain. So after people learn that I have the longest chain in the blockchain, everybody takes over my administration. And I, of course, did not include the transaction of the Lambo. So what happens is, after I publish my long chain, is that the old chain is discarded. And now I have a Lambo, and I did not pay for it. Right? All right. Maybe you also heard that you sometimes need to wait a couple of blocks before you're 100% sure that your transaction will remain valid. So what could happen is that there's a miner in, let's say again, Taiwan, that found the next block in the blockchain. And that here in Europe, there's also a miner that also found the next block in the blockchain. Since there's like a network latency of 4 or 5 seconds, they don't know that the other guy found the next block as well. So the guy in Europe is connected to other miners in Europe, and those miners check if the proof of work puzzle was successfully solved. And if so, they try to find the next block from the block they just received. In Taiwan, of course, the same thing is happening. So let's say that in Taiwan, miners are also trying to find the next block. Well, the chance that the next block in Taiwan is found again at almost the same time as in Europe, well, that chance is really, really slim. And the case of that happening three times, well, that's very, very, very unlikely. So after three blocks, you can be pretty sure that the transaction that was processed will remain in the blockchain forever. But you do need to wait like three blocks. So this is called a temporary fork, by the way. And as soon as now the miners in Europe hear about the longer chain in Taiwan, they immediately discard the block that was that they got from the miner in Europe. So let's now buy a cup of coffee with Bitcoin. That should be possible, right? Since Bitcoin is supposed to be a peer-to-peer cash system. So we have Julian, and he wants to buy a cup of coffee from Bob the barista. And Bob only accepts Bitcoin as payment for his coffee. Well, Julian now first needs to acquire some Bitcoin. What he can first do is download a Bitcoin wallet on his phone. And now he becomes a node on the network, a simple node that only stores the block headers, right? Like I just told. Now, he needs to receive a payment request from Bob. That's how a blockchain transaction works. So, and of course, Julian needs to acquire some Bitcoin himself. What he can do is he can go to a Bitcoin ATM, and he can get the QR code, he can scan the QR code, and then he has some Bitcoin on his wallet. How that works exactly, I will go into in a few slides as well. But he's actually scanning a private key when he scans the QR code that comes from the machine. So let's say that he got himself some Bitcoin and he scanned the QR code with his wallet on his phone. And now he can pay Bob, but he needs to know Bob's Bitcoin address. So Bob now makes his payment request. This is his register software. It's actually the blockchain.info wallet, the most frequent used Bitcoin wallet. It's a web wallet. And Bob can now push the button request, and this screen pops up. You see his Bitcoin address standing here. He can input the amount of money he wants to receive, and he can now ask Julian to transfer the Bitcoin to this address. This, of course, is quite cumbersome. He can just click the button View QR Code, and he can ask Julian to scan this QR code, and the wallet will immediately see the address that Julian needs to transfer the Bitcoin to, and also the amount of Bitcoin that he should send to Bob. So now the only thing Julian needs to do is push the button Continue. Well, before he does that, he sees one thing, that the current fee is 22 cents for a cup of coffee. This is, of course, an issue, and this is, in my opinion, also a sign that the technology is not ready yet for mainstream use. So, but it is fairly simple to pay this way for a cup of coffee. It's not necessary for Bob to wait like two blocks in the blockchain, because the chance that the transaction of Julian is tampered with is really, 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 really slim. And for €1.50, you can take this really small risk that the transaction might not go through. So it's the same thing with accepting small bills in a restaurant. You just accept them and you maybe don't check if it's false money. So when you're paying somebody in the blockchain, when you're doing a transaction to another party, you're actually doing a transaction to the public key of that person. And what you want to do is you want to exchange goods to that person. And you need to tell the network that you're the person currently holding certain assets and that you want to transfer them to the other party. And you don't want anybody listening to the network to be able to tamper with your transaction or maybe steal your Bitcoins. So this works with public-private key encryption. The idea is that you have a private key that you tell to nobody, that you keep really secret, and you use that to sign a transaction. And the network checks if the signing is correctly. And this sounds, of course, a little bit like magic. And I want to show you a little video that explains how this public-private key encryption scheme works.
Now, this is our solution. First, Alice and Bob agree publicly on a prime modulus and a generator. In this case, 17 and 3. Then, Alice selects a private random number, say 15, and calculates 3 to the power 15 mod 17, and sends this result publicly to Bob.
Yeah. Well, I don't think we have any sound. You do hear it? Okay. You don't hear it? Well, I'm not sure what is happening. I can't hear it.
First, Alice and Bob
we'll skip
agree
this,
publicly
video.
On a
it's
prime
okay.
modulus
okay, most people
and
say
a
it's
generator.
Okay. Some people, another case.
In this
some
case,
people
17
are.
And 3.
I'll continue the video.
Then, Alice selects a private random number, say 15, and calculates 3 to the power 15 mod 17, and sends this result publicly to Bob. Then Bob selects his private random number, say 13, and calculates 3 to the power 13 mod 17, and sends this result publicly to Alice. And now the heart of the trick. Alice takes Bob's public result and raises it to the power of her private number to obtain the shared secret, which in this case is 10. Bob takes Alice's public result and raises it to the power of his private number, resulting in the same shared secret. Notice they did the same calculation, though it may not look like it at first. Consider Alice. The 12 she received from Bob was calculated as 3 to the power 13 mod 17. So her calculation was the same as 3 to the power 13 to the power 15 mod 17. Now consider Bob. The 6 he received from Alice was calculated as 3 to the power 15 mod 17. So his calculation was the same as 3 to the power 15 to the power 13. Notice they did the same calculation with the exponents in a different order. When you flip the exponent, the result doesn't change. So they both calculated 3 raised to the power of their private numbers. Without one of these private numbers, 15 or 13, Eve will not be able to find the solution. And this is how it's done. While Eve is stuck grinding away at the discrete logarithm problem, and with large enough numbers, we can say it's practically impossible for her to break the encryption in a reasonable amount of time. This solves the key exchange problem. It can be used in conjunction with a pseudo-random generator to encrypt messages between people who have never met.
All right. So, this video explained how an encryption technique called RSA works. It's a very commonly used way to do communication over the internet in a safe way. It's also used, for instance, in internet banking. Bitcoin actually uses a slightly more advanced version of public-private key encryption called elliptic curve multiplication that's supposed to be even more secure. So, let's walk through a transaction on the blockchain one more time, following these steps. First, if somebody wants to pay anybody else on the blockchain or do a transaction with some other assets, then you first need to acquire the public key of that party. So the Bitcoin address is actually a hash of the public key. Then the sender should sign the transaction using his private key, and that will be sent to the transaction pool where all the miners can see it, and they can select that transaction and include it in their next block, and they can try to be the first party to find the correct solution for the proof of work puzzle and get the reward for that block. The recipient's wallets, in this example of Julian and Bob, Bob's wallet, and we'll see the transaction immediately. And if Bob's want to claim the funds associated with Julian's transactions, then he needs to also prove that he is the holder of the private key that is linked to the public key. And once the blocks are processed, then the transaction becomes definitive. So the Bitcoin blockchain only supports simple payment transactions. And it uses five different scripts that look a little bit like this. This looks like a programming language from the 1960s called Forf, and it's really limited in the number of use cases. That could be seen as a strength because it's really really easy to determine the possible applications of the script. So it's the attack surface of this language is really small. But it would be nice if we can use blockchain technology for all for other kinds of applications as well. And that's where Ethereum comes in, and many other blockchain applications as well. Ethereum was created in 2014 by this guy called Vitalik Buterin, who was the son of two Russian computer scientists. And his father introduced him to Bitcoin and blockchain in 2010. And in 2011, he started publishing about blockchain. And he was writing some interesting stuff. People actually paid him for it, just a few bucks. But he was paid in Bitcoin. And back then, Bitcoin was worth less than a dollar, so he made some pretty good money later. When Bitcoin went to $1,000, this guy was financially secured for life. But instead of retiring, he decided that he wanted to create a better blockchain that was able to process a lot more transactions. He wanted to be able to match the number of transactions Visa is doing. And Visa is processing like 2 to 10,000 transactions a second. And well, Bitcoin was so far away from that he decided that a complete new redesign is needed. And he created the Ethereum blockchain. And the Ethereum blockchain works like a distributed computer. It can run any type of application. It uses Solidity as a programming language to build smart contracts. And the smart contracts can be used to write Turing-complete applications, which means any type of application could be developed with smart contracts. The Ethereum blockchain also allows new tokens to be issued on the Ethereum blockchain. Vitalik and his team are currently also looking into another way to reach consensus in a network that doesn't use that much energy, like the proof of work consensus algorithm I talked about earlier. It's called the proof of stake algorithm. That works on a conceptual way like this. Let's say that we have a few parties in the network, in the blockchain network, that have a lot of stake, that have a lot of coins. Those parties can stake those coins as collateral in the network, and the network gets the key of that collateral, and the miners cannot claim it back. Those parties that gave the stake to as collateral cannot claim it back directly. They now get the privilege of processing transactions over other parties in the network, so they can make a living that way. And if they tamper with any transaction and the network detects it, they will lose, of course, their collateral. So they have a very important incentive to stay honest. It's a very nice approach, and it doesn't use that much energy. So smart contracts look a little bit like if this then that rules. You can program anything with it you can think of, as I just said. Nodes in the Ethereum blockchain run an Ethereum virtual machine that interprets bytecodes and can execute these smart contracts. So in the Ethereum blockchain, you can just pay another party like you can do with the Bitcoin blockchain, but you can also interact with a smart contract. Let's say that I own a company and that I want to pay all my employees on the 15 days of the month. I can transfer Ether to the smart contract, and the smart contract will detect if it's the 15th of the month, and will automatically pay out all the employees. Let's say that I want to send a package to somebody, and I order that package on a web shop, but that web shop does not have the item available in their own stock. The smart contract of the web shop could also trigger a smart contract of another web shop and ask if they maybe have the item in stock, and can also ask that other web shop to send the item directly to the person that I wanted to send it to. Enterprise blockchain. What you see as a textbook example for smart contracts in enterprise context is this vending machine that is ordering new goods automatically and doing some predictive maintenance and orders items directly and, of course, also pays for it. So this is a really nice example of what you can do with a smart contract. But way cooler things are possible. In poor countries, there's oftentimes not really a very good healthcare system. And if private clinics or state-owned clinics get money, a lot of that money usually don't end up with the people needing the healthcare. What if you could distribute the funds that people are allowed to spend for healthcare directly to the people using blockchain, and they can decide for themselves where they get their healthcare? That's a really nice example, and actually I'm currently working with a party that is trying to implement this in Nigeria. Check diploma. If you get somebody at your desk and he wants to work at you and he says that he got a degree from Harvard, how can you be sure that this claim is valid? Well, Check Diploma offers a blockchain application that stores all the claims of people to certain degrees. And what the person now can do is that he can provide me a code that I can use to verify if a diploma is correct. Of course, the universities also need to agree to work with the system, but this is a really nice application as well. Then Walmart is working together with a couple of parties in a supply chain solution in China at the moment. So consumers can see what happened to all the ingredients from the products that they're buying at Walmart. So let's say the farmer grows some carrots. He needs to input data into a blockchain application that records which pesticides are used. Also, at the warehouse where the carrots are stored, it will be recorded at what temperature and how long the carrots were there, et cetera, et cetera. And in the end, the consumer can, in the Walmart shop, scan a QR code, and he can see all the data that was gathered in the blockchain that is associated with the product he's currently holding in his hands. Blockchain is censorship resistant. Nobody can change any data on the blockchain. There's of course a lot to do about privacy in Facebook, also about Twitter that is supposedly censoring all types of tweets at the network. And a lot of people don't really like that. So there's a social media blockchain called the Steam blockchain that offers a decentralized experience to people that want to share all kinds of content. Like, for instance, what you see here is DTube. DTube is based on the Steam blockchain. It works exactly the same as YouTube, but it's made in a decentralized way. All the parties that are hosting the content, they are, of course, again, paid in cryptocurrency. When should you use blockchain? Well, we can better say, don't use it, because it's fairly inefficient, costs a lot of computing power to use blockchain, and if you can just work with a regular database, then it's probably better for you. If you can just rely on a central party, then that's okay. So it usually doesn't make a lot of sense to use a blockchain application in a company that is has authority over the data that is processing in that application. And it's very hard to update a blockchain application as well. You need to convince all the nodes in the network to install the latest version of the blockchain software. So try to work around blockchain as much as you can. Only use it if you cannot trust a central party or you want to make a third party obsolete because it's, for instance, very expensive. Possible applications. My last minute, if you want to record who owns what, it's a very good solution. Land registry is a nice one. Tracking and tracing, which I gave an example of with Walmart, and a lot more. And these are basically the times that you do want to use a blockchain. And I do want to leave some time for questions, so this is my last slide. This is my Bitcoin address, by the way. If you want to transfer any Bitcoins to me, please go ahead. And if you have any questions, please let me know. I don't know if any of you actually used Slido. Oh, it's who pays for transaction costs to miner? Well, if I do a transaction with another party on the blockchain, then I, as the person that initiates the transaction, needs to pay a fee. And that fee is collected by the miner. So there are like 2,500 transactions in a block. And every transaction has a transaction fee associated with it. And those fees go to the miner. I'm not sure if that's exactly what you meant by that question. If it's OK, I guess. What will be the main areas of blockchain usage in your opinion, and when will it happen? Well, I think the best possible application for blockchain technology is financial transaction, because of the following reason. If you're keeping track of who owns what in the blockchain, then you're always talking about some external goods, like land, music, video, or whatever. And there can always be another party that can always say, well, it's really nice that the blockchain says that you own this, but I'm going to completely ignore it and take your stuff anyway, right? A blockchain application doesn't enforce people listening to it. In the case of a financial transaction, the good that you're actually transferring is the money itself. So you can always be 100% sure that if you receive the transaction, that you actually own what the transaction says. And if somebody transfer the rights to a piece of land to you, then it can still be the case that somebody is not actually giving you the land in the real world. So I would say financial transactions for sure. And also, like I mentioned, in poor countries where you don't have a good governmental system, a blockchain for healthcare, providing funds for healthcare, can be very efficient as well. I think that's a very good application as well. In the Walmart example, you mentioned the farmer would enter the information. What stops the farmer from providing false information? So in the case, an example of Walmart, Walmart is actually enforcing its suppliers to use this application. If you want to do business with Walmart in China, you need to use their application, and they will also audit you on a regular basis. So they will check if the inventory of the farmer, of the types of pesticides he has at his farm, are in line with the types of pesticides he says he used for the carrots. So there's some kind of checking in that way. Of course, this is not watertight, but I think it's pretty good. Will you be sharing the slides? Yeah, definitely. I will get a USB stick after presentation, and I will put my presentation on it, and it will somehow be distributed to everybody that wants to download it. That was the last question, and also my time is up, so I would like to thank you very much.